The Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome to Holy Communion from the parish of Wargrave with Knowl Hill. My name is Steve Turville and it's my privilege to be leading the service. This morning we're continuing our look at the book of Ruth as Hugh preaches from Ruth chapter 3, and we see God's providence and provision for Ruth and Naomi continuing to unfold. But first, our opening song this morning speaks of our need for God and of God's care for us. Let's sing together, "All My Hope on God Is Founded." I hope you've had a good week, a safe week, but I expect that for some this week has been difficult. We've seen the death toll from COVID in the UK reach the awful milestone of 100,000, and we know that lockdown will not ease until March the 8th at least, which will save lives, but probably cause perhaps more anxiety, more financial and relationship difficulties. So as we gather, however we come, let's bring all of our cares and all of our worries and all of our thanksgiving to God. And let's also bring to God those times during the week where we have hurt God, others or ourselves by our thoughts, words or actions. Let's pray. We say now our prayers of preparation and confession. We say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life.
Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. And we say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbour as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Collect for the Fourth Sunday of Epiphany. God, our Creator, who in the beginning commanded the light to shine out of darkness, we pray that the light of the glorious Gospel of Christ may dispel the darkness of ignorance and unbelief. Shine into the hearts of all your people and reveal the knowledge of your glory in the face of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen.
The first reading is Ruth chapter 3. One day Ruth's mother-in-law Naomi said to her, My daughter, I must find a home for you where you will be well provided for. Now Boaz, with whose women you have worked, is a relative of ours. Tonight he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash, put on perfume, and get dressed in your best clothes. Then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know you are there until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, note the place where he is lying. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do. I will do what you say, Ruth answered. So she went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking and was in good spirits, he went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. Ruth approached quietly, uncovered his feet and lay down. In the middle of the night, something startled the man. He turned and there was a woman lying at his feet. Who are you? He asked. I am your servant Ruth, she said. Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are guardian redeemer of our family. The Lord bless you, my daughter, he replied. This kindness is greater than that which you showed earlier. You have not run after the younger men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All the people of my town know that you are a woman of noble character. Although it is true that I am a guardian redeemer of our family, there is another who is more closely related than I. Stay here for the night, and in the morning, if he wants to do his duty as your guardian redeemer, good, let him redeem you. But if he is not willing, as surely as the Lord lives, I will do it. Lie here until morning. So she lay at his feet until morning, but got up before anyone could be recognized, and he said no one must know that a woman came to the threshing floor. He also said, Bring me the shawl you are wearing and hold it out. When she did so, he poured into it 6 measures of barley and placed the bundle on her. Then he went back to town. When Ruth came to her mother-in-law, Naomi asked, How did it go, my daughter? Then she told her everything Boaz had done for her, and added, He gave me 6 measures of barley, saying, Don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed. Then Naomi said, Wait, my daughter, until you find out what happens, for the man will not rest until the matter is settled today. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord according to St. Luke, chapter 18, beginning to read at verse 18. Glory to you, O Lord. A certain ruler asked Jesus, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, honour your father and mother." "All these I have kept since I was a boy," he said. When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "You still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he became very sad because he was very wealthy. Jesus looked at him and said, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. Indeed, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." Those who heard this asked, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus replied, "What is impossible with man is possible with God." Peter said to him, "We have left all we had to follow you." "Truly I tell you," Jesus said to them, "no one who has left home or wife or brothers or sisters or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail to receive many times as much in this age and in the age to come eternal life." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Before we dive in, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Please speak to us this morning for your name's sake. Amen. Let go and let God. I wonder if you've heard that expression before. It's helpful in some ways. It's a reminder to humble ourselves, to realise that there's much in life we can't control, and to hand situations over to God, to trust him. It can be a calming thought, and it can be a godly response. If we were to ask Naomi, one of the characters we've been following in this story, to come up with a spiritual slogan, it's possible from what we've seen so far in the story that she might have come up with something quite similar. Perhaps it would be a slightly less hopeful version, though. Maybe, "I've given up. The Almighty has brought misfortune upon me." It was certainly her attitude at the end of chapter 1, wasn't it? Maybe some of that attitude has resonated with the way that we have felt at one point or another. "I've given up. God has brought bad things into my life." We've seen Naomi arrive back in her hometown of Bethlehem, declaring that God had made her life bitter, that he has left her empty. And we've seen the downtrodden resignation of someone who had been battered by several tragedies. But then at the end of our passage last week in Ruth chapter 2, we saw Naomi's attitude turn from bitter resignation to joyful and expectant hope. And we saw that it was God's provision through his word and through his people that lifted Naomi out of her despondent state. We don't know quite how much time has elapsed between the end of chapter 2 and the start of chapter 3, but it's most likely a couple of months later. So we imagine that Ruth has stayed gleaning in Boaz's fields, protected and provided for, and has returned home to Naomi night after night with food for the table and also for the store cupboard. And as we start chapter 3, it seems as though we're at the end of the harvest now. And the question is, what now? Where should Ruth and Naomi turn for provision now? And what unfolds in chapter 3 has all the ingredients of a juicy period drama. There's romantic tension. There's romance pitted against restraint. There's the opportunity for scandal. There's family pressure. And there's the need for an heir. But there's also far more going on than simply that. As we go through the narrative, we're going to tease out two themes in particular, what we're going to call active dependence and active kindness. Well, let's tuck in to the passage. Chapter 3, verse 1. One day Ruth's mother-in-law Naomi said to her, "My daughter, I must find a home for you where you'll be well provided for. Now, Boaz, with whose women you have worked, is a relative of ours. Tonight he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash, put on perfume and get dressed in your best clothes. Then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know you are there until he's finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, note the place where he is lying. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do." Here is Naomi taking the initiative. This is far more than simply the let go and let God attitude that she's had up until the end of chapter 2. This is an active dependence. Naomi has come to see that the very existence of Boaz, a close relative of her late husband, someone of good standing, who happens to own the field that Ruth ended up gleaning in, and happened to notice Ruth, her daughter-in-law, is all part of God's provision. Notice how much more hopeful Naomi is than she has been up until just the end of where we got to last week. On the road to Bethlehem, she'd effectively said to Ruth, "Apart from me giving birth to another son, there's no hope for you in Bethlehem." But Naomi had counted out the gracious provision of God. But here, in her new energized outlook, she's actively looking to seek out God's provision for Ruth and by extension for her as well. And bound up in the language of what she says is the welfare provision that marriage brought in those days, and also the expectation that children might come. in a culture and a time where continuing the family line was of great importance. So here we see that Naomi realizes that God has provided for widows and foreigners through his word. There are mechanisms built into the law of Moses that protect and provide for those who would otherwise be destitute. And the two mechanisms that will come up in this chapter are that of being a guardian redeemer, something that Naomi has already mentioned at the end of the last chapter, and also that of levirate marriage. We'll come to both of these as we go through. And we've seen the law about gleaning last week as well. Here are three aspects of God's law which operate as a gracious provision for Ruth and Naomi. And it's because of these provisions that Naomi has become so excited about the growing connection to Boaz. Now we know from what Naomi has said in chapter 2 verse 20 that she's hoping that Boaz will act as a guardian redeemer. A guardian or a kinsman redeemer was a relative who would step in to bring property back to a family. It also seems that in what Naomi is suggesting to Ruth, that she's hoping for levirate marriage. And that's where the oldest living brother was to provide an heir to continue the family line. The exact legal background of what unfolds in this chapter and the next chapter is hard to determine, but there are elements of both customs. And if we look to the book of Leviticus and Deuteronomy and Numbers, we'd find some of the pieces of law which provide the background to Naomi's plan and what then unfolds. Now, Naomi's instructions on washing and dressing aren't necessarily to be interpreted to be about seduction in the way we might think. It's possible that Ruth has been wearing the clothes of a widow, the clothes of a mourner, until now. And this change of attire is to signal to Boaz that she is now available for marriage. Many commentators do comment, though, just how risque the plan is. Ruth is to go under the cover of darkness, in secret, with some alcohol in the mix, because Boaz has been feasting at the end of the harvest, and it's a harvest that's come, if you remember, at the end of a famine. So it probably has been a big party. And Ruth is instructed to go and lie down beside Boaz. And also, in the original Hebrew describing this plan, there's some innuendo in the words. But in what actually does unfold, there's nothing to suggest that anything untoward does happen. Just as Ruth and Boaz shine generally in this book against the dark background of the time of Judges, the noble character of both Ruth and Boaz shine out. We see their moral purity. And it helps us to remember that when you think that God won't provide what you need, that is when the temptation to snatch forbidden fruit is most potent, just as it was back in the Garden of Eden. Ruth and Boaz, however, are shown to be those who do trust in God's provision, and it allows them to be steadfast in their noble character, despite the context of temptation. And here is the tension that we might call active dependence at play. To seek out God's provision, but not to grasp hold of something beyond what God has provided. Both Ruth and Boaz get the balance right. Ruth asks Boaz to spread the corner of his garment over her, since he is a guardian redeemer of her family. You see that in verse 9? She's not asking, "Can I come under the duvet?" No, this is symbolic language. First of all, Ruth is echoing the language that Boaz himself used in chapter 2, verse 12, when he spoke a blessing over Ruth. He said, "May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge." And we lose a little of the resonance in translation, but it's the same Hebrew word kanaf, translated as wing in chapter 2, verse 12, that here is translated as the corner of Boaz's garment in verse 9. So Ruth is asking Boaz to spread his wing over her, just as Boaz had spoke of her coming to find refuge under the wing of God. Boaz is God's provision for Ruth and Naomi. And it's also the case that it was a custom that accompanied a marriage proposal for a cloak to be spread over the two who intended to be married. It was a symbol of provision and protection. So Ruth is effectively trying to draw a marriage proposal from Boaz. Boaz understands this and responds very kindly to Naomi. He points out that there is a closer relative who should have the opportunity to act as a guardian redeemer first. But he makes a vow. If that closer relative does not want to act as a guardian redeemer, he will do it. So what is this passage saying to us today? Well, as we've seen the theme of active dependence so far in Ruth and Naomi's actions and in Boaz's purity, we need to ask ourselves, is there active dependence in our lives? If we take the example of the two means of dependence we saw in the last chapter, God's word and his people, are we those who are actively dependent on God's word and God's people? Are we seeking out not just to read God's word, but to actively reflect on it, to remember it, to put it into practice? Are we actively making the most of those opportunities week by week? God has provided through his word. Are we actively dependent on him through that? And God has provided his people to us. Christian believers are a means of God's provision to one another. So rather than simply waiting for fellow believers to come to us to provide support and Christian encouragement, are we seeking out opportunities? Are we joining a house group? Or are we connecting with people to pray and to talk about our faith with others? And then more generally, are we practicing active dependence in our lives, in life circumstances, seeing where God is providing and then embracing that provision with gratitude? And as well as active dependence, we see the theme of active kindness in this chapter too, an active kindness that reflects the active kindness of God. Kindness above and beyond what is expected or required. Ruth's entering into a Levirate marriage and seeking a kinsman redeemer is not required of her by Jewish law. For starters, she's a Moabite, so she's not required to follow the Jewish law, but she's chosen to come back with Naomi to Bethlehem. She's chosen to bind herself to the God of Israel. And here, she is choosing to bind herself to Jewish law beyond what she'd be required to do for the sake of Naomi. She's doing it out of kindness to Naomi. It's something that Boaz recognizes. Look at what he says in verse 10. The Lord bless you, my daughter. This kindness is greater than that which you showed earlier. Well, the kindness she showed earlier, which Boaz spoke of in chapter 2, was her kindness in sticking with Naomi, in binding herself to Naomi. And as she seeks a Levirate marriage to Boaz, as she seeks out him acting as a guardian redeemer, this will mean that Naomi's land, family land, is restored, and possibly also her family tree as well. And Boaz hints at the fact that Ruth didn't have to do this in what he says about her other marriage prospects, which seem to have improved greatly from where they were in chapter 1. He says in verse 10, you have not run after the younger men, whether rich or poor. It seems as though, as far as Boaz is concerned, she could have married any number of other men in Bethlehem. But she has chosen to seek out a marriage with Boaz as a provision for Naomi. This is active kindness. And throughout the book, Boaz repeatedly seeks to provide more than is required by the law. We saw in chapter 2, he did that with Ruth in the gleaning fields, and we'll see more later in chapter 4. And we also see the active kindness of Boaz in this chapter, not just in his kindness to Ruth's proposal, but also in the way that he sends her back with six measures of barley. Do you see that in verse 15? And we see from what he says to her in verse 17 that he has in mind Naomi, remembering that Naomi was the one who declared herself to have returned to Bethlehem empty-handed. Boaz is seeking to make sure that Naomi's experience now is one of fullness, not one of emptiness. And it's actually a pattern throughout the book. At the end of every chapter, almost as a response to Naomi's declaration that her life is now empty, we see a sign of fullness. At the end of chapter 1, it was the fact that barley harvest was just beginning. At the end of chapter 2, Ruth returns with an ephah, which we remember was a very large quantity of barley. At the end of chapter 3, she comes back with 6 measures of barley in her hands. And in chapter 4, we'll see even more fullness at the end of that chapter. So Boaz is showing active kindness, and he's actually conveying the kindness of God, the kindness of God who fills the empty with good things. And Boaz and Ruth, two individuals of noble character who shine out against the dark backdrop of the days of the judges, point us forward to the one who would show active kindness in seeking and saving the lost. One who would say, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers chicks under her wings." The active kindness of the Lord Jesus, who gave everything to show kindness to us. So as we see Ruth and Boaz showing kindness, as we think of the kindness of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus, it's a challenge for us to be actively seeking out those opportunities to show kindness. And remember that Ruth and Boaz show kindness to a vulnerable older widow without many prospects. Are we those who are finding the opportunity to show kindness to the vulnerable, whether those are the vulnerable locally or nationally or globally? As we see Ruth and Boaz intending to create a household where others are provided for, it's a reminder to us to make our households, whether we're married or not, a place of provision and protection for others, far beyond our immediate family. I know that many already consciously strive to do this, and it's a beautiful picture of the gospel. And as we see Boaz treating Ruth, the immigrant widow, with such respect, it's a challenge to us to seek the opportunities to show kindness in respecting and caring for those who might otherwise be ignored or forgotten. Perhaps those who deliver or clean or collect rubbish. Those who are ignored and downtrodden across this country and across the world. Active kindness isn't simply responsive. I love the words of the Getty hymn. "Holy Spirit, come abide within. May your joy be seen in all I do. Love enough to cover every sin in each thought and deed and attitude. Kindness to the greatest and the least. Gentleness that sows the path of peace. Turn my striving into works of grace. Breath of God, show Christ in all I do."
Thank you. is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son Jesus Christ to hear us when we pray in faith. For there to be redemption, there is sacrifice involved. We pray for those who sacrificed much for the work of Christ. We pray for missionaries who give up home comforts and security to work for you abroad. We pray that you sustain Tim and Nikki and Len, and remember with thanks your help for Bob Whiteley when he was in the midst of natural disaster in Belize all those years ago. We thank you for your promise to Peter that those who left behind everything would be repaid many times in this life as well as in the kingdom of God. We pray particularly for your own clergy team here. We pray for Hugh and Grace that in this time of furlough, Hugh will be aware of the blessings which sustain and of your plan for him. Let this time be one of prayer, growth, and development. We pray for your support for John and Steve as they cover Hugh's work and cope with the difficulties of remote working. We need all our clergy to stay strong, and we pray that you will bless and support them through today's immense challenges. May they feel joy with the repayment which comes from the Lord in this life, as well as the life to come. Strengthen all your church in the service of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray that you fill our leaders and the leaders of the world with strength, wisdom, and compassion. Help them make sound judgments for their own nation and for the nations of the world. We are focused on the efforts of COVID in our community and country, but let us pray for those who face this devastating pandemic in countries which are poor and disorganised. In this century, we have seen terrorism against the West grow as a result of fanaticism, fueled by a sense of injustice. When Israel has the highest coverage of COVID vaccination, at a time when the Palestinian vaccination program has hardly started, let leaders throughout the world see that if they only look to the needs of their own people now and are blind to others, there will be retribution to come. Direct all nations in the ways of justice and of peace, that men may honour one another and seek the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your support for all households. Our family life has been under more pressure because of lockdown, job and money insecurity, and extra stresses from work and family responsibilities. Boaz acted with compassion, respect, and responsibility when Ruth had the courage to expose her plight to him. In this time, we pray for all those who are powerless within a family, when this leaves them open to exploitation and abuse. Please support them through their fear and provide a safe refuge for them. We can come to Christ in trust and submit completely, as he will redeem us and grant us blessings. We pray for all who cannot do this in their relationships, husbands, in-laws, or parents are against them, and that they know that they will be threatened. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbours, that we may serve Christ in one another and love as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. At this time, we remember those who are known to us who suffer. Our redemption has come at the cost of the suffering and death of Jesus on the cross. He bore all our transgressions, that we might be freed and live in communion with him in this life and the life to come. The bread and wine of the communion service freely offered to us, but cost Jesus everything, for he was alone on the cross. We pray that all those who suffer at this time feel the presence of Jesus at their side to carry their burdens. Comfort and heal those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the lives of those who have died. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God. I know that my Redeemer liveth, for now is Christ risen from the dead, the first fruits of them that sleep. Here, let us remember those who have died. According to your promises, grant them, with us, a share in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all your saints, we commend ourselves to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We come now to the sacrament of Holy Communion. And first, the peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer those we are with a sign of Christ's peace, and let us also offer each other Christ's peace by his Spirit who unites us. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks. And he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us your peace. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
This cup is life forever.
We say together the prayer after communion. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Let us declare our faith in God in the words of the Creed. And we say together, we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our final song this morning reminds us of God's faithfulness towards us, of his care and comfort for us, especially at this time, and of our responsibility to take God's comfort and love to others. Lord, I come before your throne of grace.
Lord, I come before your throne of grace. I find rest in your presence and fullness of joy. In worship and wonder I behold your face, singing what a faithful God have I. What a faithful God have I. What a faithful God. What a faithful God have I.
Well, thank you to everybody who has helped to put this service together this morning, and thank you, all of you, for joining us in worship. If you have time, please join us in the Zoom room for chat after the service, and the link to that is on our church website. If you can't join us, whatever you're doing, have a safe and blessed time. But now, a final prayer. Let's pray. Eternal God, beginning and end, we ask you to go with us through the coming week, to be our comfort and strength through whatever we face. Open our eyes to praise you for your creation and to see the work you set before us. Take us and help us to bring to others the new life you give us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those whom you love, and those whom you would pray for, this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.